Welcome everyone again to our Sabbath school. Pardon me. I have on the board Manasseh. We're going to cover prayer and we're going to cover Manasseh. But first I want to tell you some more about the bears that Pastor explained. So let's open up more bears. Do you have that over there? Yeah. Because one Sabbath when I was taking it a little easier, the phone rang way back in my bedroom and I wanted to go and answer it, but I was too late. But when I got back there and looked out the window, I thought, oh, thank you for that phone call, because there was this mother bear with three triplets. I could have touched, well, if I really stretched out, I could have touched them. But I didn't want to disturb them by opening a window, but I took some pictures. And I want to explain why this was so meaningful to me. Here's Mama Bear with her babies. In the little place that Leon has fenced off for me so the deer don't come in and eat the bird seed. But now the bears come in and eat the bird seed. But here's Mother Bear. I never once heard her say anything, make any noise, any growl, any whatever. Everything was quiet. I think she was on a teaching mission, perhaps, because she's getting ready to climb up over this fence. And whether her children notice it or not, we'll see. So let's do the next slide. Up and over she goes. Now, she had already broken a hole in the fence. They could have come crawling through. But she went up and over, and then out she goes, and the babies are still there looking around the food. But now in slide 6, the one that you can see, I'll move my cursor, up here has already climbed up. Wait for me, we call him wait for me. And he goes, he jumps down, and then where'd everyone go is down here watching. And next slide, you'll see, wait for me.
Where'd
everyone go? He's looking for Mama. Wait for me is trying to crawl up a fence post right there. And then little, I don't think I can
left
do it.
Behind.
Left behind, that's right. Okay, there goes wait for me up and over the fence. And left behind is not really paying much attention. But in slide 9, wait for me is ready to go to his mother and brother or sister. And left behind is following. However, left behind can only get up about this far, and he doesn't know how to breach the fence, so he falls back down. I'm seeing all of this from the bedroom window, and he doesn't know what to do, so down he goes. How do I get out to my mother? I'm on slide 13, and you can see him over here looking. I want to go too. And so the next slide, his mother and two siblings are out there, and he's still stuck inside. But mother opens up that fence at the bottom, and baby goes out. Now they're all together, and here's in slide 16, you can see Leon had tried to patch it, so the patch is bent down. Mother's getting her nose into the fencing there to make an opening, and the baby has come back in, obviously. But they go in and out. But what I was impressed about Mother Bear is she left her babies in that little enclosure. The babies weren't afraid. They weren't looking around. They stayed and ate birdseed until mother seemed to be gone quite a while, and then they tried to climb out. However, when she was nearby, she would go up this part of the area and check it out, and then go down here and check out, look down toward the driveway, look behind the house. She was always on guard for her babies, and her babies had nothing to worry about. They weren't crying and whining. They were, this one in slide 18 is trying to get the sunflower seeds, and 19 doing a pretty good job of it, I might add. They're going to push it down. Here comes mother. Anyway, now mother again. I'm in slide 21 is trying to show her. Mother could have gone through the hole in the fence, but she, for some reason, wanted to climb up there. Up she goes, next slide, over she goes, but she doesn't jump down. I've learned that bears don't do that. I'm in slide 24 now. This bear didn't do it, I should say. And she's walking across the top there, but then she turns her bottom around and she goes down like that. She's going down outside. I'm in slide 27. Going down, 28 down, again. And that's the end of the little pictures. I left some of them behind. But the lesson, the nature lesson I would like us to remember is Pastor brought out several texts last week about a mother bear and how she's so protective of her children. And I watched her do that. She would go in and out. She wasn't eating. She brought her babies in to eat, I guess. She ate some. I do have some pictures of eating some. But she was more on the alert. She was out, went up this way and looked, went down this way and looked, came back, doing that two or three times. And God, He never leaves us alone. He doesn't have to disappear to check things out. And we can safely abide here in our home on this earth. Hi, Samantha. Hi, Sharon. We can safely abide here in this wicked world where dangers are all around us because God is like that mother bear who will not let anything happen to us. And this mother bear loved her babies. Okay, now we want to let's think about prayer for a minute. As I said, we're using this quarterly from Young Disciples out in Washington State. It's an Adventist place. And each week we have a little lesson that they send to us. And if you would like to obtain that, it's youngdisciples.com, I think. You can follow along with us. But we have some of the slides here to share with you. But what did we learn last few weeks about prayer? What points did we learn?
Having a place.
A place, Tamala says.
Having a time.
A time.
Pray out loud.
Pray out loud. And I added in my little note that it's quite all right to pray silently. You don't have to pray out loud. But for young people learning to pray, hearing their prayers seems to help reinforce this experience of prayer. So Elder Frisee recommended young people pray out loud. So having a place, a time. I'm sorry?
It was a statement from the Spirit Prophecy.
To pray, that's right. Ellen White also says to pray out loud. But there are times when we don't, and it's perfectly all right to pray silently. Okay, and
bring the mind back.
And bring the mind back because, thank you, Tamala, because when we pray, especially if it's silent prayers, it's easy for our minds to wander, you know. But if we're praying out loud, that might be a way to keep us focused. But if our minds wander, we need to come back to it. Now, I'm looking at the lesson from the School of Prayer, Priceless Blessings. We'll go on to slide 2. There's our memory text found in Ephesians 6:18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplications for all saints. And that's why when we, as we go through this quarterly, I would like for you to have a prayer journal. Each one of us to put down our prayer requests, because it says supplication for all saints. We're not just praying for the things that, go right ahead, that we're concern ourselves. We're to be praying for others too. And we're going to have a story a little bit later about Dwight Moody and how he prayed. Perhaps you're familiar with George Mueller. And he prayed. He relied on the God of heaven to help take care of the orphans. He was a man of prayer. But Dwight Moody was also. And you can be too. So keep your prayer journal and have at least one person or one problem that you see that you would like God to help you with or help the other person with. And God will answer. If we have surrendered our lives to Him and are not holding on to anything that we know is wrong, because remember Isaiah tells us our iniquities separate us from God. So we want to confess our sins, ask God to forgive them, and then to pray for others. Next slide, and for ourselves. This lesson also, on this particular page, the opening page, that we need to also develop a Bible study journal. I want us to do a prayer journal, but as you're studying God's Word, it helps to, I know when, before I got really involved with raising children and doing other kinds of things, that I had my own little journal where I wrote down things that were meaningful to me from Sister White, from the Bible. Maybe you have marked your Bible when you've claimed a particular promise and God has answered it, and you just, I just put the little date in there, not really big, but just to remind me, here's something I claimed and here's something God has answered for me. Now, so, you want to keep a Bible journal, as my Sabbath school class, Ashley and Benjamin, a Bible journal, anyone else who's listening, as you're studying God's Word, you could do it for your morning devotional. Take a chapter, write down the verse that means the most to you from that particular chapter. Pardon me. And then maybe it's a promise you want to claim for this day. Perhaps you have difficulty doing one particular thing, like being neat, making your bed, I'm not pointing fingers at anyone, or helping mom and dad around the house, or whatever it is that you want to improve on. You can put that in your prayer journal, that this is something you're praying to God about for yourself, and see how the day goes, and keep that particular promise, pardon me, in your mind during the day. Okay, next slide. You need to open your Bibles to James 5:16, perhaps, unless you already know this. It's true. The blank prayer of a righteous man, blank much. What do you think, Ashley?
Effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much.
Very good. And Pastor talked about this righteousness last time, you know. Okay, prayer helps us to become like Jesus. And this is 2 Corinthians 3:18. As we spend time with Him, we become blank into His blank. Well, okay, the next one I ask, I'm going to let Benjamin look it up and tell us, okay? So Benjamin, you get ready, we're going to Luke 18:27. Yes, but as far as this one is concerned, we become changed into His likeness. Prayer also puts us in touch with God's power. Things that were impossible become blank. Luke 18:27. What do you think, Benjamin?
And He said, the things which are impossible with men are possible.
Ah, that's right. So whatever may look impossible to us, those things are possible with God. Great promise there, that what seems impossible is possible with God. Okay, next slide. We'll skip that one. We'll go to slide 6. Monday, our praying Savior. Prayer is powerful. When Jesus was on earth, He accomplished things by praying, things that He could not have done in any other way. For example, and we're going to Luke 22:32, and Tam will let Tamala read Luke 22:32. For example, Simon Peter was so self-confident that he didn't even realize how much he needed God's help. Jesus taught Peter and warned him, but that was not enough. Luke 22:32 tells us that Jesus also blank for him.
He prayed for thee, but that thy faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren.
Okay, so Jesus prayed for Peter. Does that mean that He might be praying for us? What do you think? Do you think Jesus?
Yes. Yes.
Right. And all things that look impossible through the power of God can be possible. Okay, we'll go to Tuesday's lesson now. This is a review of what our young people have done through the week, hopefully. Paul needed prayer. When he wrote to the Ephesian church, he asked them to pray that he would be able to speak blank for Christ. That's Ephesians 6:18-20, and we'll let Sharon find that one. If you have it, Sharon. We're glad you're with us, Sharon. Okay, 20. Let's do 6:20.
for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that I therein may speak boldly as I ought to speak.
Okay, so how did Paul want to speak?
He wanted to speak boldly.
And I believe he probably did, spoke very boldly. Thanks, Sharon.
You're welcome.
Okay, so that's another thing. Our pastors, the little lesson is called Powerful Pastors. Now, Raquel, in 2 Timothy 1:3, we are told Paul also prayed for his fellow pastors. He told Timothy, the pastor of Ephesus, without blank, I have remembrance of thee in my prayers, blank and blank. 2 Timothy 1:3.
I thank God, whom I serve for my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers, night and day.
Very good. So without what did he pray?
Ceasing.
Without ceasing, night and day. So if Ashley is awake in the middle of the night, you could be praying. Pray for me, so I'd be a good grandma to you. Okay. All right. Let's move on to Wednesday's lesson. Do you have friends in the church who act like they don't care about God? Do they talk about foolish worldly things? Are you uncomfortable with what they like to do and where they like to go? If so, our lesson encourages us not to gossip about them. Tell God what you see. Pray to God about the things that bother you, and pray that God will bless these people that you have concerns about. So, in Psalms 51:10-12, I think it's Benjamin's turn, Psalms 51:10-12, we have a verse somewhere in there that says, create in blank a clean heart. Everybody wants to see Benjamin. We haven't seen him for a long time.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Okay, thank you. So, David is saying, create in me a clean heart, and renew a right spirit within me. Restore, I didn't have you read this, restore, Ashley, can you do that part? Restore unto somebody the joy of thy salvation.
Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, uphold me with thy free spirit.
Okay, thank you, Ashley. All right, so David is praying of a need he has. When God answers this prayer, you will be able to, verse 13, Tamla, of that same 51, verse 13. God's, you can come around if you want so people can see you too. I'm sorry, we'll have to make a better plan, Pastor. It's up to you.
Yes.
Okay.
Verse 13?
Yes.
Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee.
Oh, good. Thank you. So David says, if you do this for me, create in me a clean heart, then I will be able to teach transgressors God's ways. Through you, something will be something.
Sinners
will be converted. Right. Okay. And Thursday's lesson, you know what? I think I'm going to let the rest of this go because we can come back to it if we need to. But we want to get to Manasseh. So every one of you either open up to 2 Chronicles 33 or 2 Kings 21 because I want to make a comparison of these two accounts of Manasseh and what might be different with them. So let me get this back together. 2 Chronicles 33 and 2 Kings 21. So while we're doing this, I would like for us to figure out what we know about Manasseh. What, somebody give me one thought about what we know about Manasseh.
Bad
king. He was a bad king in the beginning.
Okay. Okay. Well, we have to document what you said from Scripture. So what, are you in Kings or Chronicles?
I'm in Kings.
In Kings. So Ashley, you stay in Kings. Who's in Kings with her? Ben, we'll do the Kings. Now I need at least two volunteers for 2 Chronicles. Tamla, can you do 2 Chronicles? And Sharon. Oh, okay. and Sharon do second, because we want to see if they say the same thing. Ashley says in 2 Kings, what did you say, Ashley? He was 12 when he became? When he became king. Does Chronicles tell us that also? Chronicles people? Does it tell us, 2 Chronicles 21, does it tell us he was also 12, or does it?
2 Chronicles 33 on the screen.
Yes.
You're right, 33 in Chronicles, 21 in Kings. Yes, it does. So also 2 Chronicles tells us he was 12 years old. Mm-hmm. He was 12 when he became king. What's another fact in 2 Kings 21, Ashley? Or Benjamin, do you have a fact?
It says that he did which was evil in the sight of the Lord.
Okay, does it say that in your other place? He was evil. 2 Kings tells us that. Anything else we can gather from 2 Chronicles? Yeah, you have to read on. It's not right in the first. Okay. Okay, thank you. Now back to Ashley. I need another fact from.
He reigned 55 years.
55 years in Jerusalem. Does it say that in the other one? In 2 Chronicles?
Yes, it does.
Yes, it does. 55 years. Okay. Let me get my Bible now. Because there are things we're missing right in that first chapter, first verse. 2 Kings 21:1 tells us also something else. What
his
else?
Mother's name was Hepsi.
Oh, his mother's name. So 2 Kings tells us his mother's name, but you won't find that in Chronicles. Hepsi. Okay. Now, I'm in 2 Kings, so let's just read on in verse 2. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord after the abominations of the heathen, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. For this is what he did. In verse 3, how many things can you find in 2 Kings 21:3 that he did? Read them off to me.
High places.
What else?
The altars for Baal.
Altars for Baal.
Negro.
Right. Made a grove.
All the host of heaven.
Oh, yes. And worshipped the host of heaven. Now let's look at 2 Chronicles 33. Is there anything else in 33 that's not mentioned here in 2 Kings?
Because the children passed through the fire?
Yes. 2 Kings tells us that too, but yes. But just focusing on this, there's something I was going to bring out. Oh, in 2 Chronicles 33, in verse 3, who did he rear up altars for?
Hezekiah, his father.
His father had torn them down and he put them back up. That's true. But if you look at 2 Chronicles 33, verse 3, it says he reared up altars for
Baal.
Is that the same as over here? Ben said altars for Baal, but over here it says Balaam. Are these the same? What do you think?
Yeah.
You think they are? Okay, well, let's keep moving on in our slideshow now. In slide 3, I have listed some of the things we've already mentioned. But he worshipped, and he caused Judah to worship all the host of heaven, the Bible says. Now, what do you think the host of heaven is? I'm looking here in 2 Chronicles 33:3. And worshipped all the host of heaven, and not only worshipped them, he served them. So, what were these hosts of heaven? Could it be the sun?
The sun, the moon, the stars.
The sun, the moon? Let's find out. Deuteronomy 4:19. And I'll read that one just to help move things on quickly. Deuteronomy 4:19 says, And lest thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven, and when thou seest the sun, and the moon, and the stars, even all the host of heaven. So here's a verse that helps us understand what that whole stuff heaven in context is. It's the sun, the moon, and the stars, even all the host of heaven. Okay, let's check out while we're in Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 3. It says something very similar. And hath gone and served other gods and worshipped them, either the sun or moon or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded. So, not only did he do it, not only did he have his people do it, do you know where he did this? Let's find out. Let's go back to 2 Chronicles 33. Well, Jerusalem is a pretty good guess, but a little more specific. We're going to be Google Map and go right down to where they did that. Okay, high places, it's true, and groves. However, he did something else.
The altars in the house there.
Ah, where are you reading that, Ashley?
2 Kings 21, verse 4.
2 Kings 21, verse 4. And I'm in 2 Chronicles 33. In verse 5 it says, and he built altars for all the host of heaven. Now we've already figured out that sun, moon, and stars, basically. For all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. The court of the sanctuary. So you see, it's not, he built the groves, yes, and he made altars here, or had other people do it, but he also brought it right in to God's sanctuary. He established false worship in God's home, his sanctuary, his temple. And not only did he have the people worship there, he served them. I have no clue how you can serve something that's inanimate, that, you know, like a rock, unless Satan is behind all of that, and I'm sure he is, making them feel good about doing it or something. I don't know. But he not only worshiped, he served them. Let's go to the next slide. So, in this context, I'm talking about in this context because we know that there is a host of heaven that serves God. Okay, but in this context, the host of heaven is the sun, the moon, the stars, probably the constellations, even the Milky Way, whatever might be up there. Okay, now I have a question for you. Are worshiping the host of heaven and worshiping Baal the same? In the Bible, when we talk about, like Manasseh did, worship the host of heaven, is that the same as worshiping Baal? It's not a trick question, it's just, what do you think? I see a yes, I see a yes. Mm-hmm. I see another yes. Well, not quite. We're going to find out. In the next slide, Balaam. Remember, we put Balaam here. Second Chronicles has Balaam. And 2 Kings mentioned Baal. Balaam is just plural for Baal. It's the plural form. It's like saying the Baals. Baal is the singular false god. Balaam is plural. So in 2 Kings, Baal is mentioned, but in 2 Chronicles, Balaam is mentioned. And that just helps you get an idea that there wasn't just one idol, Baal. There were many. Now, if we look at the next... Yes, Ash?
Doesn't Baal mean Lord?
Yes. Ashley asked if Baal means Lord. Yes, it does. Do you have a question?
Well, my mind is thinking a counterfeit. I mean, you know, like you have, it looks the real thing, it's all the real things, but it's a counterfeit worship of...
Yes, that's right. And Tamla was bringing up that this Baal and Balaam is like a counterfeit worship. True, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. In slide 10 are just a few examples of the word Baal used in the Bible. Baal Peor, Baal Beelzebub, Baal Zephon. So those are just examples. I'm sorry. Now I'm back to normal. But in slide 11, we read, in addition to reinstituting false worship, the Bible tells us Manasseh was evil, And Manasseh made Judah to err worse than the heathen. Manasseh made, thank you so much, made Judah to err worse than the heathen, Canaanites, the Philistines, or anything else. Now I want to ask you, would setting up this false worship in the temple itself, as well as in groves and in other places, is that any worse than what Adolf Hitler did? Remember, he was responsible for killing millions of people. 11 to 12 million dead, it's an estimate. Setting up a false worship in the sanctuary, is that worse than what Adolf Hitler did?
Yes.
I hear a yes in the background. What? And slide 14 just shows you some of the crematorium places. What about Joseph Stalin? He was responsible for tens of millions of people dead in places like the Gulag. In slide 16, you see a map, basically, of the Soviet Union at one time, with all of those spots are gulags. Now, gulag is basically a prisoner work camp, if I understand it. Very harsh conditions. Alex, and slide 17 shows you a picture of some of the prisoners working away in a gulag. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who's received the Nobel Prize for Literature, was once at a gulag, and he wrote about it, the Gulag Archipelago or something. Now, here's Paul Pott, slide 19. He's smiling, he's a happy person, but he's responsible for the death of 1 to 3 million people. Is this any worse than what Manasseh did? Just something for you to think about. And the next slide shows a collection of skulls from Paul Pott's time. Now, I believe, and I know, that what Manasseh did was far worse than anything that these wicked men did, because it was creating or teaching the people about idols, taking their minds and their thoughts away from God and His law and His creation. And you know, it's instituting a false system of worship, and it's far worse than anything evil man has done to anyone else. Pol Pot and Hitler and the things that they did were temporal, but what Manasseh did and his forefathers involved their spirit, eternal lives. Now, we know that God, He's promised to forgive us our sins if we confess them. Hitler, Pol Pot, anyone who's done, Joseph Stalin, anyone, you and me who've not been responsible for the death of millions of people, but we have hurt and harmed and done things that, oh, we wish we never had done. We wish that there's no record of it in heaven. We don't want anyone else to know. And that record can be expunged through the grace of God. But right now, the investigative judgment is going on, as far as I know, and each case is coming up. And that's why it's so important, Benjamin and Ashley, to ask God to forgive us our sins, because then it can be, a pardon can be written beside each one of them, and they will be done away with at the proper time. But if we haven't asked forgiveness, if we still cling, even Ellen White tells us, if we cling to just one sin, that's all it will take to keep us out of heaven. We have to surrender all. Now, slide 21 just has the heading of Manasseh's family, and we already read that. We know who his mother was. And in slide 22 is a little family tree that goes back to Ahaz. Hezekiah was Ahaz's son. Manasseh was I should use my cursor. Manasseh was Hezekiah's son. And we know the mothers of these men, of Hezekiah, his mother is Abijah. Now, Abijah is usually a man's name. Most everywhere in the Bible that I searched out was a man's name, except for this lady, who was the mother of Hezekiah. And we don't know anything about her. We don't know anything about Manasseh's mother or Ammon and Josiah's mother. We don't know anything about them. And whether they were try to counteract evil or institute evil is, I don't know. Maybe someone else knows, but I don't know. Now, we read about Manasseh's early life. I'm on slide 23 in 2 Chronicles 33, 1 through 9, and 2 Kings 21, 1 through 9. And you can further compare those two chapters. If you, why don't you use that to start your Bible study journal? Study of Manasseh's life and find out what he, how he's presented in 2 Kings 21 and how he's presented in 2 Chronicles 33. Ellen White tells us in Prophets and Kings 381, the kingdom of Judah prosperous through the times of Hezekiah. Was Hezekiah a good king? He's considered a good king. And the kingdom of Judah prospered during his time. But it was brought down, I'm paraphrasing, but it was brought down low during the long, wicked years of Manasseh's reign. And during Manasseh's reign, Ellen White tells us in this quote, paganism was revived, and many of the people were led into idolatry. Now, does God send punishment and destruction upon his people because of the way they dressed? Did God do that? Did God send punishment upon his people because of the way they talked? Were they kind or not kind? The thing that bothers God the most, and all of those things that I mentioned are important to him, but the thing that just bothered him the most was this revival of idolatry and paganism, which was a substitute for God himself, a substitute of worship. And Satan, we know, is behind it because he doesn't want us to value our Heavenly Father or his law. He wants to trample upon it and make a substitute. Next slide, page 381 in Prophets and Kings. The glorious light of former generations was followed by the darkness of superstition and error. Gross evil sprang up and flourished. Tyranny, oppression, hatred of all kind. I'm going to move on to the, I just want you to know, well, let's go to, because we're running out of time and I have a nice story I'd like to share. Page, slide 30 from Prophets and Kings 381. Yet those evil times were not without witnesses for God and the right. The trying experiences through which Judah had safely passed during Hezekiah's reign had developed in the hearts of many a sturdiness of character that now served as a bulwark against the prevailing iniquity. So what Hezekiah did, his influence helped some to be strong during the apostasy of Manasseh. Next slide. Half of that, halfway down, Manasseh shed innocent blood very much till he had filled Jerusalem from one end to the other. Now we are familiar with Hitler and Pol Pot and Stalin and the millions that they killed. We don't have any other record of what Manasseh did except this 2 Kings 21:16, where we read that blood went from one end of Jerusalem to the other. That's who Manasseh was. And I'm not trying to promote that kind of lifestyle because we're going to get to the fact that God forgave Manasseh. God did. Manasseh asked for forgiveness and God was faithful and true to do that. And so if he could do that for someone like Manasseh, he could do it for us. We're just peons compared to Manasseh, probably. Little people with no influence anywhere, except in our homes, perhaps. And in our homes, we are to be godly men and godly women and godly young people. God expects it of us. When Jesus returns, it will not just be for old people. It's going to be for young people, too. And there'll be no time to change at that time. So now is the time to develop character. I just want to tell you, one of the first people to fall during Manasseh's evil reign was Isaiah. And I just love Isaiah. That book is so beautiful. It's written in with such a beauty and has so many wonderful teachings in it. But Isaiah was murdered by Manasseh or his minions. Okay, let's see. Okay, I just want to talk about Dwight Moody for a minute. Dwight Moody was a contemporary of Ellen White. She was 10 years older than he. And you have to decide for yourself whether God used Dwight Moody or not. Dwight Moody obviously didn't have the truth about the Sabbath, but neither did Martin Luther. Now, Ashley, do you remember the story we have on the Christian Story Tapes from Aunt Sue and Uncle Dan about Dwight Moody? Anyway, Dwight's father died when he was 4 years old, and he had a hard life. He only went to the fifth grade. For those of you who are struggling in school, Dwight Moody only went to the fifth grade, and yet wherever he went, eventually, crowds of people would line up for blocks away to get in to hear Dwight Moody pray and preach. So let me just read for you. Evangelist Dwight L. Moody sat back in his chair and let out a sigh. The last few months had been the most hectic of his life. In October 1871, the great Chicago fire, had destroyed all the buildings in the ministry he had worked for so long. Now he was going to take a rest, a voyage to England, where he could sit back and enjoy listening to some of the great preachers on the other side of the ocean. People like Charles Spurgeon, George Mueller, and Henry Morehouse. It didn't quite work out that way. Moody had no sooner arrived in England than he was invited to preach. He accepted, of course, but when he stood behind the pulpit, he wished he had refused. Something was wrong. Instead of preaching with the power of the Holy Spirit, he felt like he was pulling a heavy train upgrade on his own strength. As he preached, he scolded himself. What a fool I am. I came here to hear others, and here I am preaching. No wonder I'm having trouble. As he drew to the end of his sermon, he realized he was in more trouble. He had agreed to preach again that evening. As soon as church was over, he tried to get out of it, but the pastor insisted that Moody must speak again. Two elderly sisters belonged to the church Moody had preached in that morning. One was an invalid and had stayed home. But the other attended the morning service. When she returned after the service, she asked her sister, "Who do you suppose was preaching this morning in church?" The woman guessed all the men that sometimes took the pulpit, but her sister kept saying, "No, not him." "Well, then, who did preach?" "Moody from Chicago." "What?" the invalid sister. "Mr. Moody of Chicago, I've been praying that God would send him to London and to our very own church. If I had known he was to preach this morning's service, I would have eaten no breakfast. I would have spent the whole morning in fasting and prayer. Now, sister, go out of my room, lock the door, don't let anyone in, don't send me any dinner. I am going to spend the rest of the day in fasting and prayer." That was the invalid sister. Moody, however, trudged into the church that evening with a heavy heart. But how different everything seemed. That night, all the powers of an unseen and eternal kingdom seemed focused upon that audience. As he drew to the end of his sermon, Moody found the courage to make an altar call. When he gave the invitation to accept Christ that very evening, about 500 people rose to their feet. Moody was so surprised, he thought the people must not have understood what he had asked. He motioned for them to sit down and then said, "If any of you really want to accept Christ, please come with me to the vestry. The pastor and I will be there to speak with you." As soon as the service ended, crowds of people streamed into the vestry. Moody turned to the pastor. "Who are these people?" Pastor looked puzzled. "I don't know. They don't belong to this church." "Are they Christians?" "Not as far as I know." When the room was filled, Moody repeated his invitation. If you want to accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of life, if you want to surrender your will, please stand. Everyone rose. Moody still felt there must be some sort of misunderstanding. He motioned for them to sit down. This is a serious decision, he told them. I want you to really consider what I'm saying. If you want to let Jesus into your life, if you want to give up your sins and worldly pleasures, if from this moment forward you want to live for Jesus, please stand. Before Moody's amazing eyes, everyone stood. They still must not understand, he thought. I'm going to Ireland tomorrow, he told the people. But the pastor here will be with you. If you really mean what you say, what you've promised tonight, meet him tomorrow night. And I just want to tell you a little more about Moody. He had an associate, R.R. Torrey, T-O-R-R-E-Y. And Torrey wrote a book about what made Moody, just a little small book, maybe 90 pages, what made Moody so great. And one of the things that made Moody so great in his eyes was his prayer life. He always rose at 4 a.m. to pray before the day started, to pray and study. And Moody always believed that if he didn't spend time in God's Word, he would not have what it took to preach to the people. Now, it's true, he didn't have all the truths that we know today. And he worked in England a lot also, and here in America, he was born here in America. But his appeal went to a lot of the uneducated people, the coal miners, the people who had such a hard life. And maybe couldn't even read, I don't know. But Moody was able to reach the hearts of those people that a lot of other ministers who had much more education, much more ability, so to speak, than Moody. Moody was a people's pastor, and he was able, through the power of God, to speak to the hearts of these uneducated people who had basically no hope. They weren't able to read God's Word, but Moody preached it to them. And I have another nice little story about Moody, but maybe next time. It's time for us to close. I'm very happy to have been here with you today, and I'm glad that you decided to join us. And like Paul, who said, leaving those things behind, I press on. Now, you know, we usually think about the guilt of our sins. We're leaving them behind. We've asked forgiveness. God's promised to forgive. And we're not going to bring them up to our minds anymore. But there are some other things you might leave behind. Maybe in the past, you had plenty of means, and now you're poor. Maybe in the past you had good health, and now you don't. But Paul says, leaving those things in the past, we are to press on toward the mark. And so from today forward, let's focus on our Lord and Savior. Let's spend time in God's Word, time in prayer, forgetting what we failed to do in the past or what we used to have. Let's focus now on today and pressing forward to serve our Heavenly Father in Jesus Christ. Let's pray, shall we? Father, please bless our time here. Help us to understand how great you are. You forgave Manasseh, and you can forgive us no matter what is darkening our hearts and our minds. Let us come forward to you, Lord. You have never turned a sinner away who's come to you asking for help. So please help each one who's listened today. You know their hearts. You know my heart. We only want to be perfect, Lord, in your sight and ready for Jesus when he comes. So please cleanse us from all unrighteousness, I ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, and until we meet again, may God watch between us. Bye for now.